when the clock ticks down toward the end of the first half, everybody pulls out the stops, goes for the three-pointer, the touchdown, or at least a field goal to get to the locker room with that all-important momentum for the second half. Well, Daytona International Speedway has no gridiron, no hard court. It's 2.5 miles of blazing hot asphalt, but every team in the field for the Pepsi 400 is out to make a big play tomorrow as the first half ends in the chase for the 97 Winston Cup Championship. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain. Welcome to the garage area here at Daytona International Speedway, where it is unbelievably hot. I mean, we'd all be a whole lot better off if it was 20 degrees cooler, but the fact is, it's not. I'm about to get run over by Mark Martin. That should be good. There's no place to hide from the heat, and there's no place to hide from the happy hour pressure.
Happy hour at Daytona. Yes, we have a need for speed, but not a search for speed. There's a search for comfort. The question is, how do you handle the heat? Or rather, how do you handle in the heat? That's what Dale Jarrett's about to find out as DJ straps in. The question is, it's 102 degrees out here right now. It's 99 in the shade, but on the racetrack, it's 125. And a moment ago, in this race car, they calculated it's 134 degrees. Can Dale Jarrett and 42 others tolerate 400 miles in that kind of pressure cooker? We'll find out if the next hour tells them about what's going to happen here in the heat today.
135 degrees in the car. Can you believe that?
That's what I thought he said. Folks, I wish we could take your hand and put inside that car and just grab hold of the shifter and realize how hot it is in those cars.
So what are these guys thinking at this point?
Well, right now, some of the guys are going out and just run a couple of laps and put cover the car up. Mark Martin told me this morning, he said, my car is really good, but we just want to try a couple, three things to make sure we can't find something better than what we had. Other guys are still searching, trying to find that perfect setup. And a lot, that's what we'll see. Some guys going in early and fellas staying out. Some guys staying out for the entire 60 minutes.
Now, I'm not sure he's searching for speed because he's going to start on the outside of the front row tomorrow, Dale Earnhardt, but he put a lot of laps on that car this morning in practice.
That's what 0 for 42 will get you. Dale Earnhardt realizes this is his best chance since the Daytona 500 to pull off a victory, and he will be probably out there this afternoon running 15, 20 laps trying to find that perfect setup.
Well, there's another guy on the racetrack who is on a hot streak, and that is Mark Martin. Sterling Marlin, however, is one of those guys that Benny spoke about who is struggling, Dave.
Well, he's the defending champion in the race, so when you struggle and you're the defending champion, that's no fun. First qualifying, you didn't get to make your run yesterday. What happened?
Well, we got some shocks on here that I didn't know nothing about to want to qualify. And you know, the car was unbalanced, them shocks, and just picking the back wheels up off the ground. So we just come in, and we just run while I go just to get a lap in, get a feel. And run this morning, we was about fourth quickest in practice, and the car drove good. And we're just going to wait and put the race motor in tomorrow and run so it's better. So keep your fingers crossed, maybe we'll win it.
A lot of folks are still saying, watch that yellow car go to the front. What are you going to work on in happy hour?
Just try to keep this thing wide open all day. You know, that's what we're thinking last year was handling. A lot of cars real loose in practice this morning, so we're going to try to get ours fixed.
Okay, man, get your hat on and go to work. That's Sterling Marlin giving us an extra moment here as they button things up under the hood. It has been a troubled weekend for the defending champion in the Pepsi 400.
Sterling was one of seven drivers who re-qualified today in second round and was the fastest, I believe, in the second round qualifying. The three cars that will not be participating in the race tomorrow that had to go home as a result of qualifying are the 29 car of Jeff Green, the 7 of Jeff Bodine, and the number 91 car of Loy Allen.
There we see, that is Robbie Gordon in the 40 car. Greg Sachs has been driving that car some, but it is Gordon this time. Mark Martin and his teammate Jeff Burton, the two back cars, the white and blue car and the red and black car, Jack Roush owned automobiles.
They had some pretty good packs for him this morning, drivers drafting on each other and seeing what kind of a car they work best behind, and it looks like that they will be doing so in the happy hour too. Look at Jeff Gordon, he's signing autographs, not the least bit concerned about his situation of happy hour. Jerry, what's going on down there?
Well, actually, Jeff had gone back to the truck. We told you how oppressive the heat is here in the garage area. Now Jeff begins to jog toward the car. The crew actually was just getting finished putting the race engine in and what they are planning on doing because of the fact that it's a brand new car and a brand new engine. And Jeff is actually now at a dead gallop. headed toward the car. Earnhardt just now coming out of his hauler, having been meeting with Larry McReynolds and the crew. He will climb in his car. This car, the one that finished second at Talladega. Yes, folks, it's the same car. It took that wild tumble here with 12 to go. Earnhardt, one of the guys who thought he could win the Daytona 500 for the very first time. They put the new sheet metal on. They fixed the roof. And Earnhardt back at Daytona to try to win his third Pepsi as he gets cinched up. Getting back to Gordon momentarily. Gordon's going to run three 10-lap segments. But don't expect to see Earnhardt run that much. He ran some long segments this morning. They want to get the car comfortable for a few laps, and they'll probably cover it up. And when Earnhardt covers it up early in happy hour, if that happens, folks, the guys in the garage know that's a bad sign for them.
Good action on the racetrack. Look at these drafting packs forming now. Rusty Wallace leads one down through the tri-oval with Bill Elliott and Dale Jarrett behind him. Jeremy Mayfield there also.
Bill Elliott told me that McDonald's Ford in Daytona during the Daytona 500 was the best car he had ever had at Daytona. So I look for big things from Bill Elliott tomorrow. And Jeremy Mayfield finished about 6 or 7 in the Daytona 500.
Now another group of cars catching up with the first group. That's Ernie Irvin down on the inside. Here is the 8 car of Hunt Strickland now going inside of Jeremy Mayfield into quarter number 3. They were running 2 and 3 abreast through the 3rd and 4th corners this morning. It was awesome.
This is from Bill Elliott's Robbie Gordon's car. I'm sorry, looking back at Mark Martin.
The pole sitter for tomorrow's Pepsi 400 will be the same man who sat on the pole for the Daytona 500 in February. Mike Skinner will lead them to the green flag tomorrow. His teammate Earnhardt will line up alongside. John Andretti with a great qualifying effort yesterday. We'll start 3rd, then Gordon 4th. Spencer with a good run. Rusty Wallace. Billy Standridge is surprised there, qualifying 7th fast. Michael Waltrip will start 8th in Mast and Speed. Nemechek, Trickle, Rudd, Schrader, and Benson complete the top 15.
16 through 30, Dale Jarrett, Elliott, Mark Martin, Hutch Strickland, Bobby Labonte, Ward Burton, 21, 21st, Musgrave, Burton, Jeff Burton, Ernie Irvin, Bobby Hamilton, Robbie Gordon, MC Wallace, Hope, Little, and Marlin, 30th.
And there's the remainder of the field with Mayfield, Shepard, Dahlenbach, Darrell Waltrip, Terry Labonte way back in 35th position, Green, Marcus, Petty, Craven, and the provisionals Budine, Nadeau, and Steve Grissom. So that's your 42-car lineup for tomorrow, and the Pepsi 400 as ESPN Speed World will have it for you live. Jeff Gordon won the Daytona 500. He'll try to make it 2 in a row here tomorrow. Our coverage begins with NASCAR today at 10:30 Eastern Time on the Deuce tomorrow, and then coverage of the race at 11 o'clock Eastern. At Daytona, they have come out of the garage together, and they have gone onto the racetrack together, Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. And here comes the 30 car of Johnny Benson to run with the duo. Well, it looks like Jeff may be coming in already, or at least backing off.
I don't know, maybe the car is just not getting up to speed, and maybe Ray Martin told him, look, run a couple laps, get a plug check. So he doesn't want to be in front and get that plug check. But meanwhile, he's got a big pack of cars approaching from the rear. There we see him coming.
Bill Elliott still leading this group of drafters. Ted Musgrave now is right behind him. And as you said, Benny, in view of the fact that the car ran so well at the Daytona 500, certainly Elliott is a contender tomorrow. The pole sitter, Mike Skinner, led one lap after starting from the pole in the Daytona 500. Jerry is with him.
Well, Mike, they're out there on the racetrack. First of all, congratulations on the pole yesterday. You're sitting here listening to a radio. Who are you listening to there, your teammate?
I'm listening to a little bit of everybody here. We're scanning some of the guys out on the racetrack. We're, by the way, where we need to be right now, but we're still working.
Now, where you need to be, basically behind me, Terry Elledge, who runs RCR engines. He's the whole engine man as far as overseeing all the engine compartments. Behind you, changing a motor. Was this by design?
Yeah, this is the race motor. It just took a little while getting it in, I guess.
All right, so your plans, I'm told, are maybe to go out and run the last few minutes of happy hour?
Yeah, we're a little bit loose this morning. We're going to run the last few minutes of happy hour and see if we can get the car locked down just a little bit better in the back.
this morning was a little bit wild with you and Spencer and Martin. You guys were bumping and banging out there at about 185 miles an hour. What was that about?
Well, you start letting them push you around, they'll push you around every week, you know, and we got a good race car. We're not going to lay down.
I'll bet you he's not. He will start from the pole. Let me show you what we're talking about if we can. Get on this left side. We'll go to the driver's side door, possibly, if we can make it over here. And I want to show you, they're working on a cool seat inside the car. And we'll show you some marks here on the side of the car here. This is where they had some scrub. This morning in practice, you see these marks here were part of the 3 and a 31. It's been scraped away. That's where the contact was with the Mark Martin car. And behind this tape, they told me I could peel it off, so I'm going to. We're going to show you. There's actually a hole in the door where part of the door panel came through. That's how hard they hit going into turn three. They hit three different times, Mike Skinner and Mark Martin. Folks, don't tell me they don't rub when they race here at Daytona when it's hot in July.
Darrell Waltrip has recently left the garage area. He was one of the last cars to go out. Darrell's hurt. He spent much of this weekend over in the therapy center here in the infield. No, he didn't crash. Well, he did crash, but he crashed 2 years ago at Charlotte. He's had an inflammation in that shoulder that comes back periodically, and it has really acted up this weekend. So he's been very, very sore. Just as he was getting ready to leave, I stuck my head in the window to try to ask him how he was feeling. And before I could get a word out of his mouth, he said, "Who won that race on Thunder the other night? I fell asleep before it was over." Jeremy Mayfield has just climbed out of the car. Let me grab a quick word with him. Boy, you're all smiles lately. How about right now about this car and happy hour?
Well, we're not too bad. We need to get a little bit better. We're a little loose. I think everybody's going to be fighting that. The track's getting slick. A lot different was this morning, but hey, this Kmart Arch Cola Ford, it usually runs good here, so just have to keep working on it, find out what'll happen.
10th in the points and a lot of consistency lately, but I hear there may be a gear change coming here during happy hour. Is that the plan?
Yeah, it is. Like I said, we run good this morning, and this afternoon's a little bit different. I think it's what we're going to see tomorrow. This place gets really slick, and when you have to start backing out or rolling out of the gas here, it makes a big difference, so we got to put a little lower gear in.
All right, we'll get out of your way and let you get busy here. That's Jeremy Mayfield. Terrific consistency for that team in the last few races, and they're going to try to continue it with a little lower gear here. That's the next change coming. Jerry?
Well, this guy here made them hold their breath in qualifying. He was the next to the last car to go out, and they were holding their breath. John Andretti, you qualified third, but many thought you were going to knock Skinner off the pole.
Well, I think it speaks volumes of this RCA team. I mean, they've just hung the body on this car and just got it done, and no testing and just a few practice laps. And to be able to run that quick, I was real surprised. It surprised me, too.
The rocket you had at Talladega, you sat on the pole with back in May. You kept in the truck. It's a different car, as you said. Now, race situation. You've been out for a few laps. How is the track?
Well, the track's real greasy. I mean, you know it's going to get hot and greasy here in Daytona. And so we brought a car that we thought that would be more comfortable to drive the whole distance. And if you can keep it wide open the whole day, that's the car to beat. So we're trying to beat that car.
How about the scramble at the front? You've seen practice this morning. Everyone sat and watched how wild it got in practice. Is it the heat that's getting these guys, making them want to get up there, maybe even rub in the corners at 185?
I don't know. Maybe it's a weekend off. Maybe NASCAR gave us too much time off. I don't know. It's, everybody gets out and they want to run good. And it's the start of the second half of the season, I guess, or close to it. So everybody's trying to make the point. And I think that, you know, for us, we're just going to play as cool as we can and do like we did at Talladega. Try and be in a position at the end to maybe win it.
All right, this guy should be a contender. They are awfully strong and awfully confident. They're not going to make many changes. In fact, the word is their engine program getting put stronger and stronger. Two guys that build them, Tony Santana Cola and Bob Fisher. They call them inside here Soda Bob and Tony Cola.
As you can see on the racetrack, Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon still running together, and so is Johnny Benson right there. Upcoming also is Ernie Urban.
Remember, Jeff Gordon pulled over and let Earnhardt go by. Well, now he's been able to just about run him back down. So it looks like it's a pretty good race car. I guess that's probably concerning Earnhardt right now that 24 car was able to fall back. Gets right back up to him. And here he's trying to take the lead, or pass Earnhardt, not the lead, trying to pass Earnhardt in the trouble. But
Earnhardt hanging right in there, isn't he? Line into turn one and make the pass.
Just driving down the hill, and that the resistance, the less resistance going down the hill is all it takes. Momentum to go by.
Jeff was the fastest in the morning practice session with a lap of 189.6. Jerry.
As you watched Jeff Gordon, remember this morning, as you said, Bob, he was the quickest car, but the car was not very comfortable. He could go by Earnhardt in the morning session, but once he got by him and cars caught him in the draft, Jeff's car number 24 got very, very loose. They made some significant adjustments to try to tighten the car up. That's what they wanted to see. They knew they could probably go back by the 3 car, but when the cars catch the 24, how stable will that car be in the draft this morning? It was not very.
Well, he seems to be pulling away from the pack right now, although we do have Earnhardt and Benson running side by side back of him. But Jeff Gordon, the points leader, coming into the halfway point of the 1997 NASCAR Winston Cup season at Daytona. We'll be right back. Earnhardt has pulled in, getting a tire check down in front of us.
Waiting for the Goodyear engineers to come by and stick that barometer in there and measure the temperature on the tires to make sure all four tires are approximately the same temperature. There the engineer comes.
Well, the Richard Childress team, among those teams that have 2 and 3 cars, came out with the best qualifying results. Skinner first, Earnhardt second. How about Rick Hendrick? Jeff Gordon will start fourth. His teammates, Labonte and Craven, are way back in 35th and 39th. Sabco Racing, Joe Nemechek leads the charge there. He qualifies 11th, Gordon 26th, and Dahlenbach 33rd. Dale Jarrett was the best qualifier in the Robert Yates stable with a 16th, Ernie Irvin 24th. And the Jack Roush team, Mark Martin will start 18th, Musgrave 22nd, and Burton 23rd. So those three cars are pretty much together in the middle of the field. There is Mark Martin, who is up to second position in the points as we enter this race, 92 behind Jeff Gordon. Looks like he's coming in as Sterling Marlin and others stay out there. I guess he just came out on the track, so he's getting up to speed.
You see Jack Roush on top of his truck watching the cars go around the racetrack.
And Dave Despain has more.
And we took a quick look at Mark Martin's car when it was in here for a track bar adjustment. The most interesting thing is not the donut on the car, which, by the way, did not come from Skinner, but from a little contact from Jimmy Spencer. Point is, everybody out there was banging into each other this morning. It was one of the wildest practice sessions we've seen in those terms, because it doesn't pay anything to win practice. When Mark was in a few moments ago, the thing I thought was significant was that they went up a click on the rear track bar. They were trying to loosen the car up a little bit. All we have heard today in the garage area is loose, loose, loose. And of course, the issue here with all the heat and the track getting slicker during the course of the day tomorrow is, how loose do you dare start the race knowing the conditions are going to get worse? We've been watching people try to tighten up their cars. Mark Martin said, I'm going to loosen it up just a little bit. If it feels good, we're going to park it.
See Martin around the racetrack slow. I guess he's probably waiting for Jeff Burton. Let those two guys hook up, two Roush cars hook up. Or it could be he's waiting for a big pack. We'll just have to see. At this time, there really isn't a big pack on the racetrack, so I guess you'll have to choose Jeff Burton and carry on.
Well, speaking of Jeff Burton, Jerry is with another Burton.
Standing by with Ward Burton. And Ward, you've been out on the racetrack. We are seeing some adjustments now ongoing with the car. What do you need to do?
Well, working on the rear shocks a little bit. We tried something in the rear shocks, tried to tighten the car up somewhat. This track gets such a hand, turn into such a handling track later in the day and later in the month of July that we have to really work to get the balance of the car. The guy that can hold this thing wide open all day here in July at Daytona will be the guy that can win the race.
This morning, I saw the crew working on the car. They're working on the chassis, guys, with the tuning on the engine. But you were sitting in the seat working inside. What were you working on?
I'd worked on my rearview mirror. I've worked pretty hard over the years to get my rearview mirror. I can actually see out of the quarter panel right here if a car's under me, and I can see over there. So I've virtually almost eliminated my blind spots. And, you know, you can't always adjust by going just by the mirror. You have to do your instinct. But between my instinct and that rearview mirror, I almost always know everybody's around me.
This car didn't qualify well here in back in February or at Talladega, but ran awfully well in the draft. An eighth place finish and 500, fourth in the class. You feel comfortable about your shot tomorrow?
Got a good car, got a good team, got a great sponsor, probably the best sponsor out here. Not because they're a high sponsor. MBNA gives back to the sport. And we've got a lot better team, and we're sitting in points right now. I made some mistakes. We broke a little bit, but we're going to show for the year's over with. It's 22 car. We've got everything it takes to win the race.
All right, Ward Burton, he was a factor at Talladega, running third on the green flag pit stop, and he had a problem with the engine as he came down pit road. They're going to make an adjustment to try to tighten the car up and head back out in happy hour.
He'll start 21st tomorrow, and when we'll come back, we'll talk to the man who won the Daytona 500 in 1989 for his only victory here at the Speedway, Darrell Waldron. No, tomorrow is race day. This is happy hour. We got about seven or eight cars and a drafting line out there being led by Rusty Wallace with Mark Martin tagged in right on his tail. Back is also in the group along with Derek Cope, Jeremy Mayfield, Michael Walter, and Sterling Marlin. Well, we promised you a conversation with Darrell Waldron, but we're going to fulfill that. That is if Dave is standing by ready to go.
And if Darrell finishes signing autographs and has time to come over and talk to us. When you've been to war a few times, you come back with a few wounds. Now, what's the one that's acting up here?
Well, at first they said I had had bursitis. Then they said I might have arthritis. I know it's some sort of situs. Now they think I got a bone spur. And actually, I've been driving the last three or four weeks basically with my right hand. I can't, my shoulder is real, I just can't lift my hand up. And fortunately, I can get it on the wheel, and that's all you do is pull down with your left one. So it's one and a half hands, let's put it that way. But I'm going to the doctor this evening, Dr. Albert Gillespie, who is, he's kind of like God to me. He fixed my leg and my arm and all when it was hurting, but when I got it broke before. So
better than punch?
Well, he does a different kind of deal. See, I mean, Doc's as good as there is at what he does, but this guy's a real doctor. I take it back.
I've heard enough about you. I want to tell you about this race car. I saw that thing out there this morning at practice. It was flying. You may be beat up, but it looks pretty good.
We didn't qualify very well, but that's not a big deal here. But the car it's really good. And I'm pretty happy with it. I just went out there just now and cranked off pretty good laps.
You wait till you get sick again.
I got to go now. I got to get in my car.
I think I'll just duck out of this perhaps. You better go back out and run some more. Car's good.
You didn't tell me he was nearby.
I didn't know it either.
Way up there. No, the car's good. Parts America car's running good. And we're going to have a good day. We'll have a lot of fun tomorrow. Watch out. Here comes a wild.
All right. We're going to get run over by Rusty Wallace next. We've been run over by the best of the business. Waltrip's directing traffic during happy hour.
Okay, Jeff Gordon backs out of the garage once again. We go down to Jerry.
You mean Dr. Punch?
Yes, the doctor.
Well, I'll try after being slammed by DW. Really. Well, anyway, we'll do the best we can. Well, here's a guy that'll tell you that I'm a decent doctor, right? I'm okay, right, as a doctor?
Well, you know, DW is getting a little older. He's getting that Alzheimer's stuff, you know, and he gets a little confused every now and then.
Good for you, Matt.
Hi, Darrell.
He just climbed in the wrong car. How are you feeling, by the way?
I feel real good, actually. Not real happy with the way we're running, but I feel good physically.
Diagnosed this week with a break of the fracture in the left leg. You didn't know it. I mean, you knew the leg hurt, but you didn't know it was broken until early in the week, and yet you raced at Michigan and California. Not a problem here?
I feel real good this week, actually, other than it's too hot. Anything you can do about that? It's way too hot. But other than that, I feel great. It's hot for everybody, though, isn't it?
They just told me just now from our computers upstairs that maybe they're overheating, I don't know, but that you're the fastest car in happy hour right now, and that's got to be pretty good, and you're not happy with the way the car's handling.
Well, the draft can, I know what lap it got me in. I lost the draft, and I picked the draft back up, so I made a run on everybody. That right there shows the fans how important the draft is. I've been out twice, and I found my way from the front to the back twice, so that's how good our car is, and I caught the right draft and ran that fast by coming from the back. So that's just how important the draft is. We were real fast this morning, and we've lost it. We got to go try to find it.
All right, we'll let you go back and find it. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
189.39 for Jeff Burton, and they're still searching for speed, but they're also searching for comfort, as now Jack Roush is looking underneath the hood of this car. Jack surveying the plugs and trying to get this car dialed in, maybe get a three-car sweep, as Hendrick did here in February.
Bobby Hamilton has the second fastest lap of this session that has been caught by the timing and scoring devices. Brett Bodine third, then Rick Mast and Ernie Irvin. You will not see on this list the number three car, and I don't know, I guess his transponder isn't working, but he was not shown as far as speed is concerned in the morning session, and we don't see him showing up in the afternoon. I don't know whether that's by design or not.
Well, neither do you see the 24 car, the Winston Cup points leader. Jeff Gordon is not on there either, so... And again, Jeff Burton told us that he knows what lap he ran 180. Now, most of the laps that I've clocked, the cars have been running the 185, 186 mile per hour average. We see the groups of cars going by. That's what they're running, 185, 186.
All right, Jeff Gordon out on the track once again, waiting for the pack to catch up. And we will take a break and be back with more Happy Hour from Daytona International Speedway in preparation for tomorrow's Pepsi 400. For the Pepsi 400 tomorrow underway here at Daytona International Speedway. Starting on the outside of the front row for the Daytona 500 in February was this guy, Steve Grissom. He had to take a provisional to get into today's field and will be, or tomorrow's field, and will be starting last.
Go figure. I mean, really, truly, in February, the car on the outside pole ran so well, and here, I think provisional. It's hard to understand this thing sometimes.
The pole sitter for tomorrow's race and for the Daytona 500, besides for that matter, Mike Skinner just went onto the racetrack. We're a little more than halfway through Happy Hour, and for the first time, Mike Skinner shows up on the racetrack. Meanwhile, standing by with Mike's teammate is Jerry.
Well, Dale Earnhardt's been sitting here for a few moments, so they're getting ready to send him back out. What they've been working on basically is driver comfort. Let me show you. Just behind Earnhardt, this window right here, this NACA duct, has tubes coming in. The air comes in that duct and will actually come through this black hose. Just look through the back window there, through this silver filter in here. This filter is a carbon monoxide filter that has a fan in it, which will force air through a hose down, and which is tied into Dale Earnhardt's chest, into his uniform there, which blows air up into his face. Remember, Dale Earnhardt, one of the few drivers that uses an open face helmet. That's why he can get fresh air that's been filtered of carbon monoxide and somewhat cooled during a 400 mile afternoon.
You look at the statistics regarding restrictor plate racing since we ran the restrictor plates in 1988, 37 races, and Dale Earnhardt leads in every category. Most points earned, best average finish, most wins, most top fives, most top tens, and most laps led. Trying to put that winless streak behind him and go to victory lane tomorrow, and a real good shot at doing so. Here are the stats regarding Earnhardt. 38 starts, 7 wins. Sterling Marlin second on the list with 5 wins. Ernie Irvin with 4. And Jeff Gordon has 3 restrictor plate wins. Looks like Sterling Marlin and Michael Waltrip are coming in as Earnhardt and Mayfield position themselves and will be going out here, hopefully catching this group of cars that is over on the backstretch right now. Kenny Wallace and others.
Mike Skinner was able to get by this pack of cars. Jeff Gordon unable to get by Musgrave. You see the 81 car of Kenny Wallace dove under him, and he got him hung up back there. We see Skinner just driven away, and Jeff Gordon still by.
Let's go to Davis Bain.
We're standing by with Johnny Benson, who's had a good qualifying run. He said, I'll talk to you if I ain't gone, but he's about to get gone, I think. They're going to be letting this baby down off the jack. Let's run in there and see if we can get a quick word with Benson. That was a heck of a qualifying run. What are you working on now?
Well, we're just trying to get a little bit more comfortable. It is running pretty good right now, so guys are doing a tremendous job. We're going to see if Benzo Panic stay up front.
Comfortable handling, comfortable heat.
It's not comfortable heat. It must just be the handling part.
There's no way to keep it cool in there. There's no way to keep the comfort level as far as temperature under control.
No, we tried. We went out and bought one of these air conditioning units to see if it helped, but it's still pretty hot here.
All right, I know you got to get back out there. We'll get out of your way and let you do that. That's Johnny Benson trying to keep cool and stay fast.
All right, Dave, we're over here with a man who's been hot for 2 weeks. In fact, at California, he was so hot he came from 39th to 3rd. Ricky Rudd, that has to give this team some momentum coming to Daytona.
Well, it really does, Jerry. Had a good run at Texas. Didn't start off that way earlier in the week, but it turned out to be a real good week for us. And coming off a win about 3 or 4 weeks ago at Dover, so these guys are still pumped up. But that doesn't mean anything. We're at Daytona, brand new racetrack for us, you know, trying to get this car tuned again. So we're pretty happy with it right now.
Jim Long told me you guys really wanted to focus on qualifying better. They knew you could race well, and one of your fortes drafting on these racetracks, but you wanted to qualify in the top 15, and you did it.
Well, I really owe it to these guys. They went back and worked hard on this car. It's never been raced before, and they had this car all cut apart 3 or 4 weeks ago and got thinking about how to build this car for Daytona, and they reassembled it, and it came out here with really only about 5 laps of practice and qualified 13th, and there was more speed in the car. We just didn't have enough time to get it worked out. In race trim, it's pretty racy, and it's driving really well. So this track's going to get hot and slippery, and the best handling cars that go to the front, that's what we're gambling on. This Tide Ford's handling well. Little lack of straightaway speed, but it's kind of a trade-off. You put more downforce in the car, you don't go as fast down the straightaway, but you go through the corner, and that's what we're gambling on.
That's how the car handles the heat. How do you handle the heat? I mean, we have these Freon-driven air conditioning, the cool suits, the helmets, the ice box. We showed a carbon monoxide filter a moment ago in Earnhardt's car. What do you do to stay cool?
Well, really, just think about it. This is only going to be a 2.5 hour long race, and you just tolerate it more than anything, drink a lot of fluid. And we got a good couple of good air hoses going inside the car, and I got basically an air-conditioned helmet and an air-conditioned seat that I sit in. So even if I don't use the helmet, the seat, by it being cooled off, keeps that cockpit air, which is 140 degrees. My seat probably is about 100 degrees maximum, so that's what your body's encased in, so your body really thinks it's only 100 degrees instead of 140.
All right, Ricky, good luck to you tomorrow.
Thank you, Jerry.
Ricky Rudd talking about the heat here just a moment ago. You saw Bobby Labonte. Folks, it's hot in these race cars, but it is unbearable when you pull in the garage because the speeds here, the temperatures in the garage, about 135 to 140 degrees. Folks, what's that like? Well, roll the windows up in your passenger car in the middle of July and turn the heater wide open and drive around for 4 hours. That's what these guys are going to endure here tomorrow.
It is incredibly hot and humid. Of course, the humidity also adds to the heat index, which was supposed to reach above 115 here at Daytona today. We'll be right back. The racetrack as drafting practice continues for the Daytona 500 during happy hour. Looks like Earnhardt is going to slow down and come in after running with that group for several laps.
Ran side by side with Johnny and Grin, the RCA car, for two or three laps, and then side by side for the 31 car, his teammate Mike Skinner.
Jeff Gordon has gotten out of his car, as you can see, and is talking with the members of the crew. Jerry?
Well, let's stroll over and talk to Jeffrey. He's out of the car and have a little chat here with some of the folks. Jeff, what about this session? You let you finish. I'm sorry, didn't mean to interrupt your conversation there. We saw you climb out of the car. You're smiling. Obviously, that must mean a good sign.
I don't know. I'm just smiling because car's good. I mean, we got the speed. We just, you know, I think everybody's really being challenged right now, let's say. I mean, this place, this is as hot as I can remember it ever being down here since I've been running Winston Cup. And, you know, that affects the track temperature and tire temperature. So it's pretty hot out there. Cars are slipping and sliding, but, you know, we're never completely satisfied until, you know, we try everything, and that's what we're doing. We're just still throwing a lot of things at it.
At the beginning of this session, Jeffrey, we saw you go out and pass a couple of cars, and you dropped back and let them pull away and then ran them back down. Was that with Earnhardt? Were you sizing them up to see what you had against what they might have?
Well, yeah, you know, you're just trying all kinds of different things. I had a group coming up behind me, and I was wanting to get up to speed so they didn't blow by me, but I was wanting them to kind of catch me and give me a big shove and hope that I could get by the cars in front of me and actually take the lead of the group. So, you know, again, you're wanting to lead a group, you're wanting to get in behind cars because, you know, things do change aerodynamic-wise when you get behind a car, and they're definitely different when you're out front. But, you know, we're just trying to get it the best of both worlds, so just in case we're not out front very much, we got a good handling car to maybe make some passes and get to the front.
All right, Jeffrey, good luck to you.
Thanks, Jerry.
Jeff Gordon, 7 wins. In fact, only twice in those 7 races he led the most laps. That's what he's talking about, not leading a lot, but here that doesn't mean that much. Dave Despain standing by with another driver who's a hopeful for tomorrow.
Well, one of the things you work on in happy hour is trying to get the car better, but before you can make it better, you want to get it good. And I heard on the radio just a moment ago, Rusty Waddle saying, hey, it's pretty good. Let me stick this thing up in front of your face here before you know what this is.
Yeah,
you were waving this thing around in the cockpit. This is a temperature gun, basically. Wherever you point it, it'll read the temperature. It says 112 degrees in here for those of you who think it isn't warm. How about inside the cockpit? What'd you read?
Well, that's 160, 162 in the cockpit, so it's pretty doggone hot in there. Probably the hottest I've ever seen in Daytona Beach, but we'll be okay tomorrow.
You said the car was good. You came in, you changed shocks, you went back out. Did it get better?
It got a little better in some spots, a little worse than others. And so we're going back to the original shock absorber setup and going to try some sway bar stuff. And in this happy hour practice, what we'll do, we'll just run the whole session and just load up on everything that's good and bad. And then when we're all done, we'll probably be the best we're going to get.
Sixth on the grid is darn good for you at one of these plate races. Are you happy with that?
Yeah, I'm happy with it. We were fourth for a long time, then fell back to sixth. It's a good start position for us. We were fourth at Talladega. We blew a motor. We were fourth in a Daytona 500. We blew a motor. Got a pretty good motor this time. I don't think this one's going to blow.
Look out for Rusty Wallace tomorrow.
160 degrees in that car. Wow.
As the car sits there, it's much hotter than it is on the racetrack with air steering around.
Still plenty warm, though.
Yes.
There's Terry Labonte, the defending NASCAR Winston Cup champion. We'll be back in a moment.
All take place tomorrow at 11 o'clock, Daytona International Speedway.
Be a little cooler at 11 o'clock, but boy, by the time the checkered flag drops, it will be hot again. Jerry Punch has a report.
Well, a minute ago, you saw Terry Labonte sitting here getting ready to go back out. Gary Dehart and the guys have basically been working on the car, trying to improve a little bit on the car. And Gary had told us prior to qualifying that if it didn't qualify any better than it did at Talladega, they were going to take it out back and burn it. And folks at Talladega, they started 36th today, or tomorrow they start 35th. And Terry, you said a moment ago you're 35th. That's an improvement.
Yeah, we gained on a little bit, but I don't know why. We just can't seem to get this thing up to speed for qualifying, but it seems to be okay, out there running, getting ready for the race. So I don't know. I hate starting back that far, but sometimes you got to.
The car comfortable to you in this happy hour? I know you made some adjustments a moment ago with some of the shocks. Is it comfortable in the draft?
It's close. It's not quite as good as we needed. It's about neutral, which unfortunately both ends are kind of slide a little bit with me, but that's after you run a while on hot tires. So it's not bad, but it's not quite good enough.
All right, we'll let Terry Labonte button back up with a helmet. He finished second here back in February, sixth, all the way from 36th at Talladega. He'll have to do it again here tomorrow from 35th starting spot. But one driver who's cooling his jets has already packed it in for the day. Right, Dave?
Yeah, man, it's way too hot in the garage area. I had to find a cooler spot. It's only 103 over here at the back of Ernie Irvin's hauler, and even cooler in the air conditioning where he was first to retire today. You get the award for being first to quit after happy hours. That mean you're happy?
No, the word just means us. It's like it's too hot to be out here driving.
Maybe it means you got good sense.
Well, I mean, this Texaco Avant 4 has been running pretty decent all weekend, and we just feel like that we're as good as we're going to make it. And it's a little bit loose at times, it's a little bit tight at times, so they can just make it go faster down the straightaway. And they told me they got all they got down the straightaway.
So is it an adjust as you go deal tomorrow? Logic would tell us it'll get looser during the course of the day. Do you just chase the car all day and whoever's best at the end wins?
Well, I'm not real sure what if it's going to get looser all day. A lot of times here at Daytona, a lot of times the car gets to pushing even worse. It just depends on how your chassis is set up and what tires it's actually using more, whether it's using the right front or the right rear. And my car feels like it's pretty good. We just figured we better quit while we still have this car left.
I'm going to hang out over here with you. Your teammate's working hard. He's out there in the middle of a long, long run for the 88.
Been out there for quite a few laps, hasn't he, Benny?
And one advantage to having a team car, whatever Dale Jarrett learns, they can put on the 28 car. We talked to Terry Labonte just a moment ago, and we mentioned Gary Dehart, the crew chief. In California, some folks that questioned Gary Dehart's decision on changing four tires that last time on Terry Labonte. Jeff Gordon only changed two tires, and track position, Jeff Gordon ended up 3 or 4 seconds ahead of Terry Labonte and beat Terry Labonte by about a second. So he did have a very fast race car. What happened? Terry Labonte folks had a vibration. They realized that a tire was loose, and they had to change four tires. There was no choice in the matter. They had to change four tires. So a lot of folks said, well, Dehart, you dummy, what'd you do that for? Well, he had no choice. He had to.
There is Dale Jarrett as he participates here in Happy Hour. Ricky Rudd out there also, and Rick Mast in the 75 car. Still a lot of track activity here in the closing minutes of Happy Hour from Daytona International Speedway. And folks, we can't emphasize enough, it is hot down here and humid. The air temperature well above 90 degrees, and the temperature in the race car is about 140. There are a lot of cars out on the track right now, as you're seeing from the Pennzoil copter cam. And these overhead shots are being brought to you by Pennzoil. and the helicopter that's flying over the racetrack right now. You can see that Jeff Gordon has come back out on the racetrack. Now begins to drop down off the banking, and there is all kind of information that you might want to check out on the NASCAR website. It's www.nascar.com. Information about not only the NASCAR Winston Cup division, but also Busch Grand National and the modifieds, and any kind of information that you want, you can find on NASCAR Online. Dale Earnhardt has come back out.
You see him going racing alongside of Lake Speed. That's Lake in the 9 car.
You will notice that the 25 car has a new paint scheme. At least there's a little green on the car. That's Louie, isn't it?
Louie the Lizard.
Yeah.
On the hood of the car. That's the ad campaign that Budweiser has going on these days. All that frog business.
Yep.
Well, the Lizards got angry, so they want equal time. And it's Louie and Larry or
something like that. I don't know. There's a Dave Marcus out on the racetrack along with Dale Earnhardt. Lake Speed had an excellent qualifying performance, didn't he? He'll start 10th tomorrow.
Yes.
Earlier in the program, we said that Sterling Marlin was among the second-day qualifiers. Chad Little was the fastest of the second-day qualifiers, and that will put him in the 29th starting position for tomorrow's Pepsi 400.
He beat Sterling Marlin by 6,000 of a second.
A lot of traffic out there.
Sure is. We saw Jeff Gordon just a moment ago back out at the start-finish line and pull his DuPont car in the pits. That's a strange place to back out. Either his car is okay, and he said, let me out of this mess, or his car was not that good. He did not want to be in that mess. And what the true answer is, it's hard to say. The yellow car left your screen, Jerry Nadeau.
Yep.
First time in Daytona, and what's the cup car?
Valuable time for Jerry, who needs experience, of course, on the super speedways and in drafting. He's right now drafting on Ward Burton in the 22 car.
Couple Pontiacs.
Final minutes of happy hour.
It's winding down.
Yes, indeed. Big pack of cars ahead of Nadeau and Ward Burton.
Pole sitter Mike Skinner is leading this group.
Well, we're going to take one more break and come back and wrap things up as far as happy hour on track activity is concerned on a warm 4th of July in Daytona. Back at Daytona, where the minutes click away in terms of happy hour for tomorrow's Pepsi 400. Let's take a look at the speeds that have been achieved. Jeff Burton is still at the top of the list with a lap of 189.390. Bobby Hamilton second, and Brett Bodine, who is in on a provisional for tomorrow's race, is third quick at 188.5.
See Rick Mantle in fourth spot. All the way down to Robbie Gordon in 15th, 16 through 30. Lake Speed will head that group. D.W. Darrell in 20th spot. Michael Waltrip back in 27th, right in front of Kenny Schrader, Kyle Petty, and Sterling Marlin, defending champion, 29th, and Derek Coates, 30th.
And we go down to Jerry, who is standing by with the sixth fastest in the practice. Jerry?
Sixth fastest in happy hour, but he's second in the point standings right now. Mark, it's what you guys have been thinking about, are those points, and maybe this might be your year.
Well, you know, we just keep doing what we're doing. Got a great race team here, and everybody with the Valvoline and Cummins team has been, you know, they've been on the money since mid-season last year, and we didn't win anything in the second half there, but I knew all along that we were headed for good things, and I just didn't know it was going to get this good. I just hope we can keep it going.
This is the car you won with at Talladega. Starting 18th, does it make a difference starting back past the top 15?
I think we started 22nd at Talladega with this car. So, you know, I'm satisfied with that. I was afraid that we qualified 25th with this car in February down here, and we led the most laps and had a problem on the last pit stop. So, really had a crack at it then. So I'm not saying that we're the contender to win for this thing, but we ought to be. I mean, we've got a good enough car to have a crack at it.
All right, Mark Martin, very happy with the car, according to the crew. And folks, many people believe that might be his turn to finally win a Winston Cup title. That could begin tomorrow. Let's check in with Dave.
Andy Petrie, the owner, talking with the driver, Kenny Schrader, who's qualified 14th and will now tell us how happy hour went.
It's over. It's good. No, Skull Car's good. You know, felt real good. We made some changes, ran pretty much for happy hour here. Usually, you know, you're okay or you're not, and we've fought it pretty much. But feels good. This has always been one of our best races.
All right, man, go get him tomorrow.
All right, bud.
All right, 14th on the grid, 15th in the happy hour rundown, and he says we'll be all right.
Well, this should be fun tomorrow. Again, it begins at 11 o'clock in the morning as far as the race is concerned. But Dave and the others will have the preview on NASCAR Today here on the Deuce at 10:30 in the morning. Over on ESPN is where you'll find live coverage of the Pepsi 400 at 11 o'clock tomorrow morning. Hope you'll be with us.
I'd be delighted to be here and watch these guys go after tomorrow. See who's going to walk away with the mid-season points lead and the $50,000 from Gatorade.
That's right. We will end the first half of the 1997 NASCAR Winston Cup season with the victory tomorrow. Race number 16 of the 32 race schedule. Coming up next here on ESPN2, RPM tonight with all of the information you need to know from the world of motorsports, not only the stock cars, but all the other action that's going on this weekend, including the Pikes Peak Hill Climb. Thanks for joining us. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. We'll be right back.